This stuff that I was going to talk about today, the malware side and extortion and that type of thing, the reason I think it's an important topic is because it's really hot right now. I mean, there's so much stuff that goes on when you're talking about this cyber extortion. And the biggest thing that people hear about is ransomware. The basic concept is you get these messages that'll pop up on your computer and it'll say, hey, you've been hacked. And you go, wait a minute, that's not good. And you kind of look at it, you start reading through, and immediately you kind of go into this fear of, oh my gosh, this is really bad, someone's on my computer. Generally what happens with ransomware is they're designed to block access to files on your computer. So they won't just crash your computer and make it stop working. Instead, what the ransomware is designed to do is start locking up the files on your computer. So it'll go after things that are important to you. Every picture you have, every Word doc, every Excel sheet. Their goal is basically to lock you out of the stuff that's the most important stuff to you. And then they demand some sort of a payment from you for them to unlock those files. And so, you know, in this particular one, the message that pops up on the screen says all of your files have currently been encrypted. And that encrypted basically is just saying they've made it to where you can't access the file unless you have some sort of decryption key. Those files are locked up forever and you can't get into them. Then they'll go on to say, you know, okay, now that you're locked up, if you go look at them, which if you look at your files, you'll notice a lot of times every file that you had, the file name will look a little different than before. So if you had a file that was called like Jim's picture and it was, you know, .jpg or something, it'll now say jimpicture.jpg dash and then some sort of like crypto message or something like that with some other extension. And that'll happen to every one of your files. And you go, oh no. And if you try to look at any one of them, they're gone. I mean, they're locked up. They're just gibberish and you can't access anything. And of course, for people who don't have backups, that's really, really a bad day, especially if that's all the pictures you've had of like a family trip or if it's work-related information or whatever it happens to be, it can be really bad. Sometimes criminals will even take it a step further and they'll actually change the file name completely. So now you can't even figure out what files were what. You just have a whole big list of stuff and directories with some random new serial number on them and you have no idea what that is. So now you can't even figure out what pictures you've lost or what you're trying to find in a backup because you don't even know what the stuff is there. So they're pretty good at making it very difficult for you. Next thing they'll do on the little message is say, okay, if you'd like to get your files decrypted, go to this website and we'll walk you through how you can get them decrypted. Now, of course, they're gonna charge you money and we'll get into that in a minute, but they'll give you a list of links that you can go to. The problem is that the links that they list there will almost always be gone within a couple days if they're not on the dark web. Instead, what they'll do is, you know, www.somesite.com or org or something like that, you'll try to go there, they'll have already been shut down by the authorities. So they give you a second list. And the second list is where you can go to these other websites on the dark web. Now, people who have never been on the dark web or have no idea what that is, the criminals are kind enough to give you little instructions. They'll give you a link where you can follow this and they'll teach you how you can get on the dark web so you can go and pay this fine. And they'll generally give you a certain amount of time, between 48 hours and 72 hours, somewhere around there, for you to figure all this out and then pay them to get your files back. And if you don't do it within a short amount of time, then you're out of luck and you get nothing at all. So here I have one link that you can go to, and if you go to it, it takes you to this Tor browser, and I'll get a little bit more into the dark web as we get further into this session today, but basically a Tor web browser is just like any other web browser you use. If you use Chrome or Internet Explorer or Microsoft Edge, you use some sort of a web browser to get on the internet. Tor is just another type of browser. It seems the same, it acts the same. The only difference is it's designed to access what's known as the dark web. It's going to go into places that a normal web browser can't get into. And when you're using these type of web browsers, what it really is saying is that you're going to sites that are anonymous. Everything remains anonymous. While you're using it, no one knows who you are, and the sites you're going to, there's nobody that can really figure out where they are. Everything becomes this kind of dark world, and that's why it's known as the dark web. So you go on your little browser, and you type in the link that they've given you, and they'll walk you through the steps of what you need to do so that you can provide them the money that they want. And the way they're going to generally want to get paid is through a thing called Bitcoin. They basically want that Bitcoin because it's untraceable. So the Bitcoin that you get, you can give to them electronically without them ever having to show who they are or anything else, and then they can transfer that and turn that into real cash without ever tracing back to anybody at all. So Bitcoin has become the currency of a criminal because it's so perfect for them. I mean, everybody remains anonymous in the transaction, and they don't have to ever worry about being touched. A lot of governments are starting to get into Bitcoin as well, especially governments that are kind of shadow governments, you know, like North Korea and things like that, because they realize that they can be dealing with large sums of money, and there's no one that can track where it's moving or how it's going, so you don't really have bank accounts like you normally would. I think they're right now running at about $580 per Bitcoin is what the valuation is. So it changes from day to day and fluctuates. But the point is that it's not always cheap. But if you want your files back, you have to pay. Basically, if you do pay, they most of the time will give you a key and you can actually unlock your files. Because what they've realized is people aren't going to pay. If everybody starts saying, hey, if you don't pay, or if you pay and you're still not going to get your files, people wouldn't pay. So there's some sort of honor amongst thieves there, because they will generally give you the key and then you can go in and unlock your files and you get them all back. And so people are relieved, or at least they get back most of them. The other thing that we found is that you don't have to pay the full price. There's always some way on all their sites where you can contact them. That's their starting price, and it's just like any other business. If they say they want $320, you can counter and say, I'll give you $150. And most of the time, they'll come back and they'll counter with you. Either the ransomware gets on your computer, you pay the fine, they give you the key, and either the key doesn't work at all, or it only works partial. You get some of your files back, but you don't get them all back. You know, it's not like you have a support center that you can call for these criminals. It's kind of, if they've done their code and they have good code and you get lucky, great. Other times, it won't work at all. And the most important thing with ransomware is that antivirus doesn't solve this if you like try to put on an antivirus after the fact. So let's say you get compromised and you go, okay, well, my computer has ransomware on it. I'm just going to call up some security guy. He'll probably come out with some sort of software. I'll pay him a few bucks to put the latest one on. He'll take the malware off my computer, and I'll get everything back. It doesn't work that way. Malware, the way that the ransomware is designed is that it encrypts the files on your system. The encryption is strong. I mean, this is government-style type of encryption. If you don't have a key to decrypt it, you're not decrypting it. You might be able to get the malware off your computer. That's no problem at all. But the actual thing that's done, the damage that's been done, it's still done. They can't undo that. And there's been a few exceptions. Every once in a while, an antivirus company will discover a master key to certain malware out there. And generally, it will be like months after it's been around, and they'll be able to say, oh, we have one that we can unlock some file. So if you do ever get in a situation where everything's been locked up, you don't want to pay, but you just want to move on, if you can save all of that junk that's been locked up on a separate drive, on a flash drive or something, just wait and be patient, because one of these antivirus companies may release something 6 months down the road and be able to salvage those files. So don't just give up. Don't just wipe your drive and start over. Save those files and put them off to the side and just wait and see and keep paying attention. And you'll know what the name of your ransomware is, because it'll generally have some sort of an indicator on your screen of what it was called. And that way you'll be able to then kind of reference that later. So don't ever just give up. But in most cases, if you don't pay and you don't have backups, you're probably in trouble.